Dank dat ik hier spreken darf. Ik moest het in Engels doen. Ik ben Hollander. My name is Mathieu Suters. I'm from the Netherlands. Just a quick background. I'm a member of the management team, Circular Economy of the Government of the Netherlands. I'm a member of the steering group, Circular Financing of the Dutch Central Bank. I'm also responsible for developing the Circular Product Passport ICT hardware. And I'm also a corporate development director at the Circular IT Group. Agenda. So I want to talk about the circular economy, circular IT, and talk a little bit about the Circular IT Group from an investment perspective. So in the Netherlands, the Dutch government intends to realize a fully circular economy in the Netherlands by 2050. And in the Netherlands, we have the goal that we want to halve the use of raw materials in 2030. The Dutch government developed an R letter, they call it, for circular strategies. And perhaps you can read it a little bit, but it's all about, you know, if you don't need a product, you don't buy it. Or you use less products, and if you use a product, reuse it, refurbish it. And the last step you want to take is recycling. There are all kind of impacts that products have, and those are impacts, for example, aimed at the environment. And you have to think, you see the list about climate, biodiversity, etc., etc. Now, what is the goal of the circular economy in Europe, and but also in the Netherlands? There are three goals in essence, and that's the first one is the reduction of the raw material consumption, and specifically aimed at critical raw materials. The second one is reducing the negative environmental impact of products and also of ICT hardware. And the third goal is in essence value retention, but value retention to make sure that the first two goals that I mentioned, that you can achieve them. Just to show you a CO2 emission goal from Europe, and that also accounts for Germany. We have the Fit for 55 program, so we have to reduce CO2 emissions by 55% in 2030 compared to 1990. Just to show you some LCR data from ICT hardware, because you know, all ICT hardware manufacturers, they publish LCA data already for 15 to 10 years. But what I notice is that most customers do not look at this LCA data that is published. And I just at random show you some data from free laptops, and then you see, you know, what Dell or Apple in this case, or HP say about the carbon footprint of this laptop and how much of that carbon footprint is realized by the production phase. If you look at these figures, you can come to the conclusion that climate change and global warming is caused by the production phase of products and not by the usage phase. And in the Netherlands, we focus on subsidizing solar cells on the roof, subsidizing electric cars, e-mobility. We put a lot of windmills in the sea to reach green energy. But a big part of climate change and global warming is caused by the production phase of products. The European Commission did research, and they say that at minimum, you know, 50% of greenhouse gas emissions is caused by raw material consumption, and 90% of biodiversity loss is caused by the supply chain of products. So you talk about raw material mining and production. There's a list of critical raw materials from the European Commission, and in 2011 there were 14 critical raw materials, as you can see, in 2014, 20, 2017, 27. And at the moment, there are 30 critical raw materials. I was asked by the Ministry of Economic Affairs and Climate in the Netherlands to ask to ICT hardware manufacturers what the raw material consumption is, or the raw material composition of the ICT hardware is. So I wrote a mail on behalf of the Ministry of Economic Affairs and Climate to the board of Apple, to the board of HP, to ask them, we use this laptop, we use this router, can you please show me what raw materials are embedded in the products that you send us? And then I found out that on average, minimally 22 critical raw materials are embedded in ICT hardware. This makes it probably the product group worldwide with the most critical raw materials. The problem is that if people think of recycling, they think, okay, that's positive because we win raw materials back. But for example, the case in the Netherlands is that we do not recycle any e-waste in the Netherlands because we have no recycling facility, zero. Because a recycling facility, you need a smelter, they add lead, which is a toxic element. Market leader in this field is Umicore, and they have a smelter in Antwerp, so part of the e-waste goes to Umicore. But the recycling industry is technically only able to win back approximately 5 critical raw materials. And I just told you that, let's say, 22 critical raw materials are embedded in the ICT hardware, meaning that you will lose 17 critical raw materials the moment you shred the hardware and you start to try to win back critical raw materials. So for a lot of people that are busy with this topic, yeah, it's new information, because people did not know this about the effectiveness of the recycling industry. Now, I will not say, this just gives you an idea about what are the common critical raw materials in IT equipment. I will not go through them because of the time, and perhaps you have questions. Same list, for example, for data servers. And this gives you an idea about the amount of CRMM found in a data server. Just a short talk about this one. The Dutch government developed the so-called resources scanner. And the point is that, you know, a lot of raw materials you find in ICT hardware, they're becoming more and more scarce. So my prediction is that the cost price of ICT hardware will increase dramatically the coming years. And that has two reasons. One side, critical raw materials are scarce because they are scarce. If you want to find palladium, you have an enormous mine to you have to dig a lot of ground to get a little bit of palladium. But the second thing is also geopolitical situation in the supply chain, where, for example, China is owner of a lot of mines worldwide, critical raw materials that are necessary to have ICT hardware. So this gives you, and also the end of life recycling rate, or the real recycling rate, is very, very, very low. As we know, if you order nowadays a router or a switch from certain brands, you have to wait 1 year and 2 months, or 1 year and 4 months to get those. So it's very difficult to plan also from that point of view, based on these ICT hardware. To say something about biodiversity, so the international policy goals, that's in 2030, biodiversity loss should be stopped. That is the goal. But at the moment, what you see in general is that people focus on conservation efforts. So these are compensation solutions. So planting trees to compensate for the CO2 emissions. But the goals will not be achieved if we go on like this. So we really have to start focusing on sustainable production and sustainable consumption. To say something about the Circular IT Group, which I'm corporate development director of, what you see on the investor side is that the European Commission has made laws and rules where banks, investors only are allowed to invest or give loans to companies that are sustainable or circular. So the interest of private equity funds and investors in certain sectors is increasing. So I'm building at the moment with the biggest private equity funds in the Netherlands, the Circular IT Group, and we bought 6 companies, if I'm correct, in the last 4 or 5 months. And we will build further with this Circular IT Group. So you see more investment interest in circular IT companies. This is something about the purpose of the Circular IT Group and the vision and the ambition. But to be able to achieve circular or sustainable goals from a raw material point of view and from a greenhouse gas emissions point of view, because I just mentioned to you that the most negative environmental impact of ICT hardware is in the supply chain from a biodiversity point of view and a greenhouse gas emission and climate change point of view. So, and I also explained to you that in a recycling phase, we hardly win critical raw materials back. So it's crucial that we optimize the lifetime of products and also of ICT hardware. Okay, then you look at, okay, what are the circular functions in the ICT hardware field? So when are you optimizing the lifetime of these ICT hardware? Now, and I mentioned some functions here. For example, hardware as a service, meaning the customer will not be the owner of the hardware, but will give the hardware back to the supplier, who then gives the hardware again to another customer who still can use it. It's the same as, for example, instead of, if you buy something new, shredding the hardware, but giving somebody else the chance to still use that hardware. Of course, reverse logistics, refurbishment, data mining, all these kind of functions, we apply within the Circular IT Group. So what you will find back in the Circular IT Group are companies, for example, we just bought a company in the Netherlands that is the biggest device as a service partner in the Netherlands of HP. So it's a gold partner of HP, device as a service. So they deliver 6,000, 7,000 laptops to an end customer with all services related. The laptops come back, we refurbish it, and apply the same thing again to another customer to optimize the lifetime of the ICT hardware. Now, what is very relevant if you talk about ICT hardware and lifetime is software licenses. But as soon as a manufacturer does not give any software updates or upgrades anymore, you're forced to buy a new hardware item. So what I also advise the Dutch government on this case, and in my opinion, when a government buys ICT hardware, they have to ask to the manufacturer, how long will I get software support? Because if they give a short software support, they are not willing to tell when it's end of life, or they cannot tell it yet, yeah, you cannot make a prediction about the lifetime of the ICT hardware, which from an environmental point of view is very, very negative. From a circular reporting point of view, you know, we want to give end customers reports about the CO2 emission reduction they have achieved by extending the lifetime of ICT hardware. But also, what a lot of customers don't know, that the LCR data is available. But you only have to know where you have to search on the website of the manufacturer. And so there's a lot of data available. And we still have to win a lot of data on the field of the raw material composition. But because I asked on behalf of the Dutch government to the manufacturers the raw material composition, I got this data. But of course, if I would have asked this as Mathieu Suters, yeah, then and then Microsoft would say, why would I send my raw material composition data to Mathieu Suters? So as soon as a big customer asks for it, of course, then the data is there to be able to share. We also busy with a replan IT project with the EU and the municipality of Amsterdam. Okay, so I don't know, time-wise, I'm quite okay, I see. I didn't even check. So if possible, perhaps you can ask me some questions, then we have some interactivity, which is always the best, of course. Then I just talk about something and then.
Thank you, Mathieu, Danke. For this talk. Do we have questions in the room? Yes. Yep, this one. Let's make it easier.
With the changing life cycle of IT infrastructure due to the slowing of the CPU and integration loop, do you think that it's possible that IT hardware will have a longer lifetime in the future, a much longer lifetime, like 10, 15, 20 years?
Yeah, kijk, that depends on the specification of the customer. Kijk, what I saw, kijk, the Dutch government is buying for billions of euros every year ICT hardware. And then, yeah, I don't... So the question is always, if you have, for example, somebody that uses a laptop and only sends an email and internets, yeah, what specifications do you need to be able to do that? We can discuss about that. But about performance, kijk, we as Circular IT Group offer also a software to our customers. They say you do not exchange your hardware based on the financial, I don't know the English word right now, in your bookkeeping after 3-4 years, but you should change your hardware the moment that it cannot perform anymore because of applications. So you can monitor your hardware continuously on performance and based on that, exchange your hardware where you optimize your lifetime of hardware. And that's probably the best way to optimize it because in the end it's about performance. Because yeah, like a router or a switch, there's a PCB and the only thing that is turning is the fan. And PCB never breaks. You can still use a PCB after 20 years in essence.
Okay, next question. Over here.
Tilman Bogenhagen, hello. Question about the numbers. Does the carbon oxygen footprint for the manufacturing include the mining and exploration of the...
Yeah,
Yeah. Raw material.
And manufacturing is the supply chain, so raw material mining and production. So the LCA, the life cycle analysis of ICT hardware, always exists of four things with every manufacturer. You have the production, which is raw material mining and production, or manufacturing. Then you have the transport to Western Europe or something. Then you have the use it phase, which has a carbon footprint. But if you use green energy, most data centers in the Netherlands have green energy, so we have zero carbon footprint. And then you have the recycling phase, which you have carbon footprint again.
I meant the exploration and the mining of the raw materials. Is that included?
Yeah, in the manufacturing. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. We've got questions from the internet.
Yeah, I have one question without a name. The carbon emission mentioned has been about absolute values, right? So the units are kilogram CO2 per device, ? Is there a statistic which considers which vendor device, device type, specific hardware is used for how long, ? If different in value, I may rethink to use different type of vendor.
Basically, the point is what I mentioned is the LCA data. They have to legally publish most manufacturers. Some of them publish them per device, some of them per product group, this LCA data. But there is no tool at the moment to compare this data that I just showed to you. Because the data is there, but I don't know if that answered that question that the person asked, but you cannot compare them right now in a tool, which will be useful in the future. Because if the Dutch government says, okay, I want to buy the laptop that has the lowest carbon footprint, let's say, they don't know. They don't know where to find the data on the website, and there's no comparability tool. But next to the kilogram, I would mention one thing. Is for me the percentage of the carbon footprint of the ICT hardware manufacturing compared to usage phase. Because you saw the goals of the European Commission, the Fit for 55. If you know that 60, 70, 80% of carbon footprint is in the supply chain, then the climate change and the global warming is not realized here in Germany or in the Netherlands when we use the hardware. No, it's realized when it's produced. And that's what we have to they call that scope 3 emissions. So if we're serious about the problem of climate change and global warming, if we're really serious about that, then we cannot just buy stuff, recycle it continuously, because then we're causing the climate change together. And that's the consciousness that we have to realize that. Yeah. Dankeschön. Danke.
Do we have more questions?
More.
No more questions. Well, then, thank you, Mathieu, for your
Dankeschön,
thought.
Für your Zeit. Danke.